I do not have the authority. We must fight on. The surrender of Berlin is impossible. I repeat my question. What can we expect after surrender?
As a military man, I am primarily concerned with disposing of your troops who are hopelessly defending Berlin and doing it as quickly as possible.
You, German soldiers, were ready to continue the battle for Berlin, even as the ammunition was running out, and the general situation made it unnecessary to continue your resistance.
We'll not agree to a truce or separate negotiations. Surrender and proclaim your new government. Donetsk can then come to us, as you did.
Time was dragging by slowly as Chuikov waited for a response from Moscow. He began to talk about specifics with Krebs.
I met General Guderian at Brest in 1939. He was commanding a tank division at that time. Where is he now?
Guderian was chief of the OKH General Staff until 15 March. He fell ill and went on vacation. I was his deputy.
Is Guderian's illness a diplomatic, politic, or military tactic?
I can speak no ill of my former superior, but there is something in what you say.
Have you been at the Supreme Headquarters all that time?
I was chief of Department for Military Readiness. I was also in Moscow, acting as military attaché until May 1941. Then I was appointed chief of staff for an army group in the East.
So you learned Russian in Moscow? Did you help Hitler get intelligence on Soviet forces? Where were you during the Battle of Stalingrad, and what did you have to do with it?
I was on the Central Front, at Rzhev. Stalingrad was horrific. All our misfortunes began there. Were you a corps commander at Stalingrad?
No, I was an army commander.
I read bulletins about Stalingrad, and Manstein's report to Hitler.
Would it be possible to run a telephone line from this building to Goebbels' office?
I would be glad to do it. You could talk to Dr. Goebbels. I could send my adjutant with your signals operators. That would help.
Marshal Zhukov then called. He and Chuikov agreed that the colonel who had accompanied Krebs and the German interpreter should return to their office to set up a direct telephone communications with the Reich Chancellery. By this time, several other officers had joined Chuikov at the command post. All went into the dining room to have tea and sandwiches. Everyone was hungry, and even Krebs did not refuse. Chuikov noticed that his hands were trembling. The men sitting at the table were tired. The end of the war was so near one could feel it, but the last hours were wearisome. At times, Chuikov left Krebs to go to the next room to issue orders. His commanders were instructed that whilst negotiations were being conducted, the troops should stand by and be ready to resume the assault immediately at the first signal. Goebbels, Bormann and Krebs were playing for time, perhaps thinking the Soviets would begin quarreling with the Allies, but Chuikov's troops were using that time to prepare seizing the Tiergarten if surrender was not forthcoming. The conversation with Krebs resumed. Chuikov wanted to penetrate the secrets of the Third Reich leadership, their thoughts and hopes, but more importantly, he was to continue negotiating until he got a response from Moscow.
Where is Hermann Göring right now?
Göring? He is a traitor. The Führer cannot abide him. Göring suggested that the Führer hand over the government to him. The Führer expelled him from the party.
What sort of man, in your opinion, is Himmler?
Himmler is a traitor. He worked against the Führer. He had wanted to conclude a separate peace with the Western powers for a long time and disunite us. The Führer found out his intentions. That was one of the reasons for his suicide. The Führer treasured loyalty from his companions.
So Himmler is a traitor?
Yes. According to Hitler's will, Himmler is expelled from the party. He is not in Berlin. He is in Mecklenburg.
But he knew about Himmler's proposal to unconditionally surrender to Britain and the USA.
This was a bluff, a shot in the dark. In fact, Chuikov knew almost nothing about Himmler's proposal until later. Krebs thought about it and answered,
"As you know, we suspected him, but I was not entirely persuaded until I heard that Reuters article. Hitler positioned him outside Berlin so that he could send help, dispatching all German armed forces here. But he deceived the Führer. He did not send help. Himmler, the traitor, wanted to make peace without the knowledge of the Führer. He works against the interests of Germany. I was always with the Führer. I was his primary advisor on issues related to war. But OKW was not in Berlin. It was in Mecklenburg. The Führer sent them orders directly from Berlin. I was responsible for the Eastern Front."
Who among you is now considered commander-in-chief?
According to Hitler's will, Dönitz has become that. Schöner is the new commander of the land forces. Von Keim is commanding the Luftwaffe.
Where is Ribbentrop?
In Mecklenburg. Seyss-Inquart is replacing him.
Who will be authorized to lead final negotiations with the Soviet Union and her allies?
Goebbels and Bormann. They are in Berlin and are the only executive representatives of Germany.
Will the army recognize the new government?
If there is a chance to distribute the Führer's will to the soldiers, they will carry out his mandate. It would be better to do that before the new government is proclaimed.
You fear this other government?
Himmler betrayed us and may form a new government.
How do you suggest to communicate with other regions? They are cut off.
Through a temporary truce with you. We will then announce everything.
I don't understand.
With your cooperation, we will contact outlying regions by air and other means.
Meaning the government is being created to gather forces in Germany and continue the war?
No, to conduct negotiations and end the war.
But in Hitler's will, it's clearly stated that he's creating a government of men who will continue the war by all means possible. Would it not be better for you to agree to end the war first and then begin negotiations?
My government can answer, not I.
Outside, it was already getting light and guns were thundering. The Soviet front headquarters called again, demanding the documents Krebs had delivered. Zhukov went on bombarding Chuikov with questions. He was sending his deputy, General Sokolovsky, to join the negotiations. Returning to the conference room, Chuikov continued questioning Krebs.
So the chief military leaders are in Mecklenburg. Goebbels and Bormann have remained in Berlin to fulfill the will of the Führer and form a government that wants neither peace nor war.
In the sector where there is still fighting, I agree to a ceasefire.
What purpose would that serve, since your government is not going to surrender? Do you want more bloodshed?
I want to do everything, as soon as possible, to ensure that the legitimate government in Berlin is recognized, so that an illegitimate government will not be recognized.
If you do not surrender, our troops will attack. After that, it can be sorted out where the legitimate and illegitimate governments are.
This is why we request a ceasefire.
And we demand surrender. Do you have documents other than those you presented? Is your aim here to lead negotiations with the USSR alone?
Only with you.
You with us, and Himmler and his associates with the Allies? Why don't you want to speak with all of us at the same time? Why do you prefer to act separately?
When our powers and authority are widely accepted, we will negotiate with other governments, with your allies.
Until the remnants of your Berlin garrison surrender unconditionally, your government cannot assemble here.
I came here to resolve these issues and pass on German assurances. When there is a truce and recognition of the new government, the question of surrender will be decided in hours.
Does this mean you will fight to the end? Do you know the terms of unconditional surrender?
Yes, I know. But neither the Chancellor nor Bormann can decide on unconditional surrender without informing Dönitz. Himmler has our only radio transmitter. Ours here was destroyed in bombing.
We can give you a transmitter. Proclaim the Führer's will by radio.
That would be undesirable. It would be unexpected to Dönitz. He does not know about the will yet. We are trying to appeal to the USSR. We do not want an illegitimate government agreeing to a separate peace with Britain and the USA. We prefer to negotiate with the USSR.
As a military man, I am primarily concerned with disposing of your troops who are hopelessly defending Berlin and doing it as quickly as possible.
If you eliminate the Berlin garrison, there will not be a legitimate German government.
Nonsense. I've informed you that there's only one peremptory condition, unconditional surrender.
General Krebs and his adjutant were outwardly calm and restrained, but it had to be hard for them.
I am not authorized to effect a surrender. My concern is the conclusion of an armistice.
And we insist on our demand, unconditional surrender.
The conversation was caught in a loop. Then General Sokolovsky arrived. Chuikov briefed him on the course of negotiations. Having heard him out, Sokolovsky then began questioning Krebs.
When are you going to make an announcement about Hitler and Himmler?
When we come to an agreement with you on the new government.
The front commander believes you must first declare Himmler a renegade to obstruct his plan.
Wise advice. That can be done now. Of course, only with the permission of Dr. Goebbels. I ask your permission to dispatch my adjutant to him.
You have Goebbels and the others. You must tell Goebbels that there can be no new government before surrender.
Only with the permission of Dönitz, and he is not in Berlin. We could dispatch Bormann to Dönitz as soon as a pause is declared, but we have no plane or radio.
Lay down your arms and we can talk further.
No, that is impossible. We are requesting a truce in Berlin.
You have the codes and ciphers and so on?
Himmler has them.
Chuikov and Sokolovsky automatically exchanged a glance.
If you will allow a pause, we can come to an agreement.
Only on the basis of surrender. Dönitz can then come to us, as you did.
Dönitz must be sent for. Will you allow him to pass?
Surrender, and we will allow him to pass immediately.
I'm not authorized to decide that.
Surrender immediately. We arrange for Dönitz to come here.
We must communicate with Dönitz before we surrender. I cannot surrender without Dönitz. But I could also make the request of Goebbels, if you send the colonel to him.
So, it comes to this. A German colonel goes to Dr. Goebbels to find out if he will agree to immediate surrender?
Will there be a truce, or must Dr. Goebbels agree to surrender before a truce?
We give no consent to speak to Goebbels about a truce.
Without Dönitz, neither Goebbels nor I can presume to surrender.
Then you cannot form a government.
No, we must create a government. Then we can decide on surrender.
Sokolovsky went to the next room, phoned the front commander, and reported.
Krebs insists that they cannot surrender without the agreement of Dönitz. Dönitz supposedly knows nothing. Krebs requests that they be allowed to inform Dönitz about everything, as if a decision will then follow. He requests we allow him to send an adjutant to Goebbels, and then, probably, to send another man to Dönitz. It is over a 400 km round trip drive from Berlin to Mecklenburg. He also proposes that we send our officer. Dönitz would be waiting for him on the front line. All this is a great waste of time. For now, we will allow him to send a man to Goebbels.
It was thus decided that Krebs' adjutant would go to Goebbels. Chuikov phoned the chief of staff and ordered him to allow the colonel to pass. Communications were to be established from one of the Soviet frontline battalions to a German one, giving Goebbels a connection with Chuikov.
The German government must have authority.
Do you think Hitler's authority will be preserved, given the fact that Germany is totally defeated?
The Führer's authority is, perhaps, somewhat lessened, but it is still great. His undertakings will never be undone. There will be new men. But new government will be based on the authority of Hitler.
Krebs was the epitome of a fanatic. He was speaking sincerely and was superficially impressive. His uniform had the red and gold collar insignia of a general officer and narrow epaulettes. He wore a ribbon for the winter campaign of 1941 and an Iron Cross. He continued,
"Possibly the basis will be broader, more democratic. I would concede that. But we must save ourselves. If Britain and France dictate capitalism to us, that would not sit well."
"We do not intend to exterminate the German people, but we will not allow fascism. We are not going to kill members of the Nazi party, but the party will be abolished. The new German government must be created on a new basis."
"I think, I am sure, there is only one leader who does not want to destroy Germany. That is Stalin. He said that it was impossible to destroy the Soviet Union, but also that it was impossible to destroy Germany. That is clear to us. We fear American Anglo plans to destroy Germany. If they are free to act against us, it would be terrible."
"And Himmler?"
"Allow me to speak plainly. Himmler thinks the German army is still strong enough to oppose the East. He said that to your allies. It is clear to us, absolutely clear."
"In that case, Herr General, your persistence is ultimately incomprehensible. The fighting in Berlin is blood spilled in vain."
At 0945, the phone rang. The Soviet government was offering its final choice, comprehensive surrender or the surrender of Berlin. If the Germans refused, the Soviets were to begin an artillery bombardment of Berlin at 10:40. Chuikov told this to Krebs.
"I do not have the authority. We must fight on. It will all end horribly. The surrender of Berlin is impossible. Goebbels cannot consent to that without the agreement of Dönitz. This is a great misfortune."
"We will not agree to a truce or separate negotiations. Surrender and proclaim your new government. We will give you a radio transmitter in Berlin and you will communicate with the governments of our allies."
"Yes, perhaps Goebbels can decide on that. May I go to him?"
"You may go. We are telling you everything, without reservation. Your situation is hopeless. Goebbels and Dönitz cannot even talk to one another. After the surrender of Berlin, we will give you a plane or a car and establish radio communications."
"The officers who will manage the surrender will remain free? Or will they be considered prisoners?"
"We do not know what the governments of our allies will decide."
"I repeat my question. What can we expect after surrender?"
"We guarantee that the members of a new provisional government will have the right to carry on official communications with the Allied governments. The three Allied governments must come to a decision."
"I need to find out what Dr. Goebbels thinks. I must tell him about the option of surrendering Berlin."
It was 10:40. The Soviet artillery preparation was beginning. Aircraft were flying overhead.
"May Day is a big holiday for you."
"And how can we not celebrate? This is the end of the war, and the Russians are in Berlin."
"I was in Moscow in 1941. I told you I was serving as acting military attaché. During the parade, I stood on the reviewing stand near the Kremlin."
After breakfast, communications with the Reichschancellery were established. Krebs asked his interlocutors to write down the exact terms of surrender offered by the Soviet government. He took the telephone and began talking. He emphasized one point. Himmler's act of treason should be announced by radio. Goebbels requested that Krebs be allowed to return so they could discuss everything privately. Chuikov and Sokolovsky agreed. This was a list of surrender terms. 1. The surrender of Berlin. 2. All those surrendering must lay down their weapons. 3. The security of officers and men are guaranteed. 4. The wounded will receive assistance. 5. The opportunity to communicate with the Allies by radio will be provided. Then Sokolovsky elaborated.
"Our government will declare to the three Allied governments, Soviet Union, USA and Britain, that there has been an unconditional surrender. This will partially satisfy your demands. We will not help you form a government, but we will give you the right to communicate a list of persons you do not want to be considered prisoners of war. We will give you the right to issue a proclamation to the United Nations after the surrender.
The people we list in Berlin will not be considered prisoners of war?
That is guaranteed. Officers will keep their rank, decorations and sword. We give you the right to present a list of members of the government who are authorized to communicate with Dönitz. All of this will be effective only after surrender.
And this will establish a comprehensive and legitimate German government?
Only for the purpose of issuing statements and communicating with the governments of our coalition states. They will have to decide what happens next.
At 1300, before leaving Chuikov's headquarters, Krebs spent a long time collecting his things. He returned from the stairs twice. He had laid his hat and gloves on the windowsill and forgotten them. He put on the hat and left the gloves. He returned again with the excuse that he had forgotten his field bag. He never had a field bag. From his eyes and demeanor, it was clear that the general was undecided. Should he return to the hellfire or throw himself on the mercy of the victor? Possibly he was expecting the Soviets to declare him a prisoner. He may have eagerly agreed to that. But Chuikov did not need such a prisoner now that the war was finishing. He thought it more expedient for Krebs to return, so he could use his influence to cease the bloodshed. What had been Krebs' motivations? Obviously, he intended to make use of controversies between the USSR and the Western Allies. It was no secret that there were disagreements, but the leaders of the Third Reich did not understand that even if it looked strange, this alliance had a common aim and a clear common enemy. They were seeking a fissure within the anti-Hitler coalition, but they did not find it. Having stayed with Chuikov for half a day, Krebs had seen no flaw in the Soviet loyalty to its allies. Goering and Himmler had similarly failed in their attempts with the Western Allies. Krebs was, without doubt, an accomplished diplomat, but he left empty-handed. It was obvious that this was the last attempt to drive a wedge between the Allied powers, and it failed. And so it was that after 10 hours of discussions, the Soviets agreed to recognize Goebbels as head of the government, but any separate surrender was out of the question. Since 1600 hours, on Stalin's express order, Soviet troops returned to the offensive on all sectors. The command was given, fire at full capacity and finish off the enemy quickly. Thousands of shells fell on the government district, the Reichschancellery and the Reichstag. Chuikov began receiving reports on successful operations by his troops. They fought throughout the day of the 1st of May. There was no sleep and no rest for them. They captured Potsdamer Strasse station, then surrendered the Tiergarten, the zoo, and the Chancellery. Three Soviet divisions make their way to the Führerbunker. According to some accounts, among the last defenders were drunk officers and soldiers who rushed towards the advancing Soviets, howling like madmen. At the same time, more sober groups of German soldiers tried their luck west. On the 1st of May at around 2300 hours, German defense was on the verge of complete collapse. Weidling had informed Chuikov by radio that he was sending him an officer. That officer, Colonel von Duffy, arrived at 0200 hours on the 2nd of May at the Bismarckstrasse bridge and announced to the Soviets that his superior was ready to surrender immediately. At 0400 hours, Weidling reported at Soviet 47th Guards Division headquarters. After talking with General Sokolovsky, sent here again by Zhukov, he wrote his last order.
On April 30th, the Führer, to whom we all took an oath of allegiance, abandoned us by committing suicide. Faithful to the Führer, you, German soldiers, were ready to continue the battle for Berlin, even as the ammunition was running out, and the general situation made it unnecessary to continue your resistance. I now order all resistance to end immediately. Each additional hour of fighting adds to the terrible suffering of the population and the wounded. In agreement with the High Command of the Soviet forces, I call on you to end the resistance. Signed, Weidling, General of Artillery, former commander of the Berlin Defense Zone.
The appeal was broadcast over loudspeakers to all parts of the city, while Dr. Fritzsche, Deputy Minister of Propaganda, addressed the German troops by radio, urging them to surrender. The ceasefire was effective at 1700 hours German time. A huge column of prisoners, 134,000 according to Soviet accounts, headed east. In the evening, Stalin's order of the day brought together the troops of Zhukov's 1st Belarusian and Kurnev's 1st Ukrainian fronts. In the name of the motherland, they jointly received the salute of Moscow to the victors. Was the battle inside Berlin necessary? Whatever the judgment, it seems impossible to deny the Red Army one thing. No other army in the world could, with equal resistance from the adversary, achieve what it did in Berlin. After the fall of the Reich capital and its leader, it was only a matter of days before the act of German capitulation ended the war in Europe. Germany was in ruins, as was most of Western Russia. The 9th of May 1945 was a day the Soviet people would never forget. Their emotion was impossible to convey. At a terrifying price, they had achieved the impossible. The astounding victory is one of the very few matters on which all Russians agree to this day when asked what the Soviet Union could be proud of during its 70-year history. This makes all the more vile such accusations that were heard during the Cold War, when it was insinuated in the minds of Westerners that the Russians wanted war. No, the Russian people did not and do not want war, because they know only too well what it is like. Of all peoples, the German and Russians are the most eager to do anything they can to avoid war, because they experienced the most terrible war in all the history of mankind.